So, good afternoon, everyone. And today's topic is pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. And just to give you an overview, that if you look at adult neoplasms with neuroendocrine differentiation where there's a known primary site, basically we have two types of tumors, those with indolent biology and those with aggressive biology. And most of the GI malignancies, especially the differentiated, there are differentiated neuroendocrine tumors like carcinoid, pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, islet cell tumors, paragangliomas, pheochromocytomas, and medullary carcinomas of the thyroid. And there are many others, including those in the pancreas, some in the pancreas, which are high-grade, poorly differentiated neuroendocrine carcinomas. Much depends on the biology. And I've always, every time I give a talk, it seems that I give importance to the biology, because biology is king. So if I had to give you an update of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, many people call it PNET. I think Dr. Radhakrishna also mentioned PNET as a word. But if you go to an oncologist and mention PNET, it's a primitive neuroectodermal tumor, which is a pathological entity. A pathologist also will say PNET is a primitive neuroectodermal tumor. So you mustn't confuse. So it's better to actually call it a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. And to understand that this is one type of component of a gastroenteropancreatic GEP-NET with so many cell types, 17 or perhaps even more. And these form a very heterogeneous group with very different biological behavior, varied histologic appearance, and even the response to treatment is very, very different in different groups and of tumors. Just right at the start, we need to understand that we have a functioning tumor, or you may have a non-functioning tumor. Non-functioning tumors also secrete hormones. It's just that the hormones are not in such levels that can produce clinical syndromes. 2/3 to 3/4 or even 4/5 of tumors may be non-functioning, most of whom are malignant, and they usually reach large size because they don't cause local infiltration right at the start. Probably they do not cause obstruction, they do not cause bleed, and therefore they are allowed to reach a larger size. Functioning tumors may happen from 10 to 30%, and again, there are many subtypes. Here, the converse thing is that the primary is very small. Sometimes the primary is impossible to diagnose, and the patient presents with only metastatic disease. The vast majority of functioning tumors are also malignant, except for some groups such as insulinomas, where 90% are benign. So you're talking about mostly malignant tumors with variable behavior and functional or non-functional. In 2017, the World Health Organization published a new classification. We have always tried to refine our understanding of neuroendocrine tumors, and we are much disturbed by the fact that we do not do proper reporting to a tumor registry. People who don't have cancer centers in their respective hospitals and who don't have their tumor registry often worry that if they send the patient to a regional cancer center, Trivandrum, the patient wouldn't come back. And therefore, they don't want to send the patient. They don't, many cancer centers or tumor registries want the patient. They don't want data and they don't trust the data. So this sort of impasse continues. And therefore, we don't have accurate figures. And so we are not able to learn as fast as we can. Suffice it to say that we can have well-differentiated tumors or you can have poorly differentiated tumors. And if you have, and this is based on two things. One is a mitotic index. A mitotic index is the number of mitoses in 50 high-power fields. What you do is you take an area of high density, and then you express it, you express the number of mitoses in 50 high-power fields. You can express it in 10 high-power fields, but you'd actually count it in 50. Whereas the Ki-67 index, which is the other proliferation index, you actually evaluate to more than 500 cells in areas of sort of hotspots, just like the COVID hotspots. So it is much more likely that the proliferation index will give you, it's like the, you know, the SUV standardized uptake value versus the, you know, maximal uptake value. The maximum uptake value may be more close to the KI 67 index, and standardized may be the average, which may be the mitotic index. So based on mitotic index and proliferation index, you can have G1, which is a well-differentiated tumor, G2, which is intermediate, and G3, which is a poorly differentiated lesion, which is actually a carcinoma, a pancreatic neuroendocrine carcinoma. And these may be small cell or large cell types. In addition, there are many patients who have mixed neuroendocrine, non-neuroendocrine tumors, MINEN and MINEN. And there, some of them actually have mixed adenocarcinoma neuroendocrine tumor, which can be a MANEC. So that will also decide the behavior of the tumor. And let's say we did a Whipple resection for an ampullary lesion, and then we found that it's a MANEC, and we found that the patient develops liver metastasis, then we have to find out whether the liver metastasis is from the adenocarcinoma component or from the NET component. Based on that, you'll have to treat the patient. So it's very critical when you have a mixed tumor. Busy slide, but I have to mention that it's only in the 8th edition of the AJCC classification that we now have a separate classification or a TNM system for the carcinoma, for the neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas, T1, T4, again, very similar to adenocarcinoma, but N0, N1 only. And here, the metastasis is the important thing. Metastasis confined to liver is 1A. Metastasis in at least one extrahepatic site other than liver, that is lung, ovary, non-regional, lymph node, peritoneum, or bone, as M1B. And M1C is both hepatic and extrahepatic metastasis. So this grouping has been specifically designed for neuroendocrine tumors. If you had a tumor in the liver and you didn't know where it was coming from, you can do some markers. So if you do an ISL1, it is, or an ISL1 or PAX8, it is very likely to be a pancreatic origin. A TTF1 is more likely to be a lung origin. So this further immunohistochemistry and molecular cancer classification assay can tell us where the primary is likely to be, although this is not foolproof. NEN may present isolated or as part of a syndrome, the first being the multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, where you get basically the three P's, the parathyroid, the pituitary, and the pancreatic tumors. And then the Fornhippel-Lindau disease, where you may get adrenal tumors, retinal and cerebellar hemangioblastomas, renal cell carcinomas along with neuroendocrine tumor, Fornreckling-Gosens disease, and tuberous sclerosis. All these conditions can have neuroendocrine tumors as part of their syndrome. So you have a VHL disease where you have a neuroendocrine tumor of the pancreas. The VHL cysts in the pancreas do not need treatment, but the neuroendocrine tumor needs treatment. If you had a patient with MEN, what are the likelihood or the frequency of involvement of the different components, like I said, of the three P's? So out of 220 patients, which is one of the largest series ever published, parathyroid tumors happen in 90% of cases, pancreatic in 41, and pituitary in 30. So that's a rough ballpark figure of really what should be the, you know, what can you expect in patients with we all know this slide because this is what we are very fond of talking about. We know that insulinomas produce recurrent hypoglycemia. and that's the commonest functioning PNET. Gastrinomas are next. I just need to move this somewhere where it will not be seen. Okay. And all the others, including VIPomas, somatostatinomas, are all much less common. Please remember that insulinomas are malignant in 10%, whereas more than 90% of gastrinomas are malignant. In fact, most of the other functioning tumors, most of them are malignant. So what do we do to image these tumors? This is usually how it's picked up, that the person who has some screening or some non-specific symptoms undergoes imaging and then it's found. So you can do anatomical studies and functional studies. Anatomical studies, there are three of them: contrast enhanced CT scan, an MR, or an endoscopic ultrasound. Functional scans are a gallium dotonoc PET. There is, of course, the variations of dotatate and dototoc. The OctioScan is now obsolete. In undifferentiated tumors, an FDG PET. And the new kid in the block is the CU dotatate, and apparently it is more reliable than the gallium dotatate. So the criteria for doing a functional scans is supposed to be quite precise. In some cases, you need to localize the primary tumor. After histologic diagnosis from a liver metastasis, you need to do a staging, preoperative staging. If you can't biopsy the lesion, the best you can do is do a functional scan and locate the lesions. And if you have a biochemical evidence, and you have a 5-hydroxyguanidinoacetic acid in the urine, but you can't find the tumor on conventional imaging, then of course you have to do a functional scan. This is a CT scan of an arterial picture. You can see the aorta is lit up, and you can see the hypervascular liver metastasis seen in the arterial phase compared to the venous phase. However, excuse me. Now, theater la lecture kodutondrikka. In patient B, on the other hand, it's another patient. Not all NETs are hypervascular. Some of them may not be so hypervascular, and then they are delineated better when the liver enhances, and then they are seen less more clearly in the venous phase. So while it is true that this is typical of a neuroendocrine tumor, the other type also may happen. Of course, the primary can also be found. The primary again will light up just like the adjoining artery. That is typical of NET. Sometimes the lesion is cystic, and a cystic neuroendocrine tumor can happen. Therefore, sometimes you have to, if you do a FNA, then you get a biopsy. MRI is equally effective. In the T1 image, you can see the mass as you hear, and in the T2 image, you can see the intense white lesion because of the fat suppression. And endosonography shows you beautifully this mass impinging both on the portal vein and on the common bile duct, but yet not infiltrating either of them, and somewhere in the upper portion of the head of the pancreas. Sometimes the single CT shows you both liver metastasis as well as a mesenteric mass, which suggests that there was a small bowel tumor with metastasis. But very often, the primary may never be seen. It is generally said that more well-differentiated, the more hypervascular the lesion is. And this is an example. Whereas, grade 3 tumors will have more necrosis, and because of more necrosis, they will not enhance as much as grade 1 tumors. And therefore, that must be kept in mind. Similarly, pancreatic tumors seem to be much more hypervascular than enteral tumors. This is just relative, but in general, NETs produce hypervascular tumors, but pancreas is much more hypervascular than the enteral tumors. So in this case, for example, that you see a large enhancing distal pancreatic mass with bilobed liver metastasis. Most probably, I think from memory, that this is malignant insuloma with liver metastasis. So it is now believed that the multi-detector CT can also show you by seeing whether there are lymph node metastasis and whether the portal value enhancement is less than 1.02. That is, for example, if I were to put it in simple words, if the hypervascularity continues, then it is an independent prognostic factor for worse survival. What should be done next? We should do a PET CT and biopsy if you can. So which PET will you do and why? In general, we would do for G1 and G2, because in neuroendocrine tumors, we would do a DOTA PET. And in G3 undifferentiated tumors, you do a FDG PET. And just to refresh you, that there are six dopamine receptors, 1, 2A, 2B, 3, 4, and 5, out of which 2, 5, and 3 are the ones covered by the DOTA NOX scan, the 2 and 5 by the DOTA TOX scan, and the DOTA TET is 2 and 5. The most common found is 3 and 5. So if you want to cover up all the options, then the best choice is to do a DOTA NOX PET. It sometimes is very difficult to distinguish between hepatocellular carcinoma and metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. Both are isodense, can be isodense on the plane scan. Both may undergo enhancement. The only, while there is early washout in the HCC, there may be rim enhancement, there may be variable enhancement, or delayed washout in the NET. And this may be subtle. And that's why in some cases, we may have to do other tests, or including biopsy, to resolve this. This is an example of a DOTA PET. And you may notice that there are multiple liver metastases, which are also showing up on the functional scan. And there is a hot spot in the region of the head of the pancreas, which on the CT scan shows you is a lesion abutting the duodenum and the pancreas. So it's a primary of the duodenopancreatic area with bilobed liver metastasis. What about biomarkers? The commonest biomarker that we use for pancreatic tumors are the chromogranin A and urinary 5-hydroxyindolic acetic acid and others, depending on what we are talking about. If we suspect an insulin, then we can do the appropriate test. Same is true of gastrin, etc. None of the other markers are really reliable. Chromogranin is the only basis for biochemical marker surveillance for neuroendocrine tumors. If it is increased and then it becomes normal after a section, then its value is doubled. But it has a hell of a lot of false positivities, which makes it a big therapeutic dilemma, because we have sometimes patients who have no clinical evidence of disease, no radiological evidence of disease, and just a raised chromogranin, which is supposed to be 56 up to the normal, it'll be 430. And then the clinician is really in a jitter, because he, and the patient, of course, because they don't know how far more. And many of they need to be investigated, and many of them do get unnecessary DOTA PET scans, which don't show any uptake, and then they are temporarily reassured. Most importantly, one has to stop proton pump inhibitors for a week if you want a more reliable chromogranin A result. In general, core biopsies are preferred to fine needle, although cytology can now you know, pathologists have become so good that they can diagnose it in up to 97% of cases. But if you want to differentiate G3 from G1 with a reliability, then you need 83% reliability only is possible. The idea of doing biopsy is to confirm the diagnosis and to grade the tumor and look for non-neuroendocrine components, like I said, manic. And immunohistochemistry looks for, synaptophysin and chromogranin in the tissue. We need to know what is the factors which are going to govern the outcomes in a patient with neuroendocrine tumor. And this is a recent publication, I think a month ago in Pancreas, a large study of 307 patients, in whom recurrence occurred in a quarter of the patients. And the most important grade were the stage and the grade. And they were, this is something we have to remember, that the grade is as important as the stage. So what about the neuroendocrine metastasis? If you have neuroendocrine metastasis in the liver, does the site really matter? When we do a in-depth analysis with a 24-year data published from, I think, Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, Maryland, and 421 patients, we found that the site does not matter really. Surgery remains the mainstay for neuroendocrine tumors, and we should try and resect that primary. There are some important points that we must remember. This is one condition where resection of primary is justified even if there is metastatic disease, because there have been some papers which have shown 100 months versus 35 months survival in those who have had resection. So all patients, even if they are metastatic, must be seen by a surgeon, because there may be a role for surgical therapy. Debulking is only useful in functional tumors, not in non-functioning tumors. And even there, it should be frowned upon. Functioning tumors must be removed. And non-functioning tumors less than 2 centimeters, there's some controversy whether we should do really resect them. I think most people do, but there's some controversy, no uniformity of opinion. But if the tumors are above 2 centimeters, they must be resected. When you do surgery, you must do an oncologic operation. You must do regional lymph node dissection and try and achieve an R0 resection. Can we do an enucleation? We can reserve it for selected cases, well-circumscribed, benign insulinomas, some well-differentiated tumors with no involvement of the pancreatic duct and no evidence of regional lymph node or distant metastasis. But I tend to think that the only group of patients in whom I would treat by enucleation is insulinoma. And I'm going to now show you some pictures. This is a head of the pancreas, and you can see the mass there, and it's actually attached to the superior mesenteric vein. So this is a great example for even arterial resection is justified in neuroendocrine tumors. And so here the tumor has been resected with a segment of the superior mesenteric vein, and the same has been reconstructed in the tumor. This is an interesting patient who had a neuroendocrine tumor which appeared to be infiltrating the superior mesenteric vein, as you can see here. And you can see the tumor evolving. And in fact, the main superior mesenteric vein goes like this. And this is the first jejunal vein, which is very much dilated. And it was possible to do the resection because this portion was infiltrated by the tumor with the transection here and the transection here to remove the SLV without doing an anastomosis or a reconstruction. And as you can see here, the stump, this is the SMV going directly under the neck of the pancreas. This is a branch, as you can see very clearly. It's not even going in the same axis. So you've ligated the SMV and ligated the SMV again below, taken away the segment, and that's the final result. In other cases, there may be multivessel resections required, and this is an example of a pancreatic tumor where a coronary resection was also required. In patients with extensive liver metastasis, metastasis in the left lobe as well as multiple in the right lobe, we may need to do a portal vein embolization or a portal vein resection, ligation, to allow the left lobe to hypertrophy so that it's so large now that safely one can do a right hepatectomy. At the other end of the spectrum, you can have small lesions, and this lesion is close to the gastroduodenal artery and the hepatic artery complex. And you can see the portal vein below the tumor, the nodule seen here. What we are not sure is whether the pancreatic duct is involved. And I think when we looked at the pictures we took, we found that there is actually a little bit of duct seen. In fact, you see that better here. You can see this tenting. This is the nodule, which is enucleated, patient with insulinoma. But once you remove this, then you realize you had made a hole in the duct and you could put an infant feeding tube going both ways. It was placed in the duct and the duct repaired. But despite that, the patient, as you can see, the duct repair going on. The patient had a pancreatic fistula, pure pancreatic fistula. This was in the era of open surgery. And then the patient was managed by an endoscopically placed stent, as you can see here. The tip of the stent is seen here. And the patient's symptoms subsided. This is a similar insulinoma in the uncinate process, close to the supramedullary vein. And it was enucleated successfully, as you can see here. But postoperatively, there were problems. And the patient developed bleeding and producing, with a pseudoaneurysm, producing GI bleed, which was required in angiogram and embolization. And the problem was, as I will show you in a subsequent picture, that there was also feeding from the superior mesenteric artery. So we had to take care of both ends. A typical example of a distal pancreas mass with liver metastasis, and the distal pancreas is first resected with the colon, and then of course portal vein embolization and augmentation of liver function followed by further surgery. This is an example of a large lymph nodal mass close to the superior mesenteric vein in a doctor, and at operation you could see a large lymph nodal mass between the supramedullary vein and the medial border of the duodenum. And it was considered possible, technically possible, to locally resect it. But some weird conviction on the part of the surgeon allowed a Whipple to take place. And you can see that the neck has been displayed and the pancreas stump preserved. And this is the other end of the pancreas. At the time of the specimen, you could see that this is all lymph nodal mass. But when we opened, cut open the duodenum, we found an umbilicated nodule in the duodenum. And this was a gastrinoma. So this was cured because of the decision to do Whipple resection rather than a lymph nodal excision. This is a patient, young patient of 35, who was presenting to Dr. Matthew Phillip with persistent diarrhea. And he had been treated for quite a long time by various physicians for irritable bowel syndrome. Eventually, an ultrasound was done and that showed a pancreatic mass, and then surgery was done and surgery resected the pancreas. The histology was VIPoma and the diarrhea subsided. Last but not the least is the instance of multiple tumors in the pancreas in a patient who has got suspected neuroendocrine, MEN, multiple endocrine neoplasia 1, and then they have to be treated on their own merit. Must we do R0 resection in neuroendocrine tumor? In general, yes, R0 resection is a good idea for everybody. But when the margin status and long-term prognosis of primary pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors after curative resection was considered, improved recurrence rates, the margin positive people had higher recurrence rate, but no difference in overall survival. In fact, re-resection of that margin, if it turned out to be positive, was really not beneficial. How do we do surveillance? This is very important. 3 to 6 monthly scan and chromogranin A testing and CT, MR or DOTA scan when required. So some studies have shown that a diffusion-weighted MR is probably one of the best methods, especially because MR doesn't produce any radiation, and therefore it may be worthwhile doing chromogranin A with an MR periodically. Not all patients who have neuroendocrine tumors have surgery as a possibility. There are many non-surgical options ranging from lutetium dotatate targeted therapy, therapy with drugs like everolimus, sunitinib, pasopanib, long-acting somatostatin, platinum-based chemotherapies, and even metformin, and ablative therapies like radiofrequency ablation, microwave ablation, and cryotherapy, etc. There were a set of radiant trials, 1 to 4, which largely placed everolimus on the map of neuroendocrine tumors, which produced improvement in the progression-free survival for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors as well. However, it's quite toxic, as some of my patients have reported. And a wonderful new drug is metformin. Before I go to metformin, I must talk a little bit about long-acting somatostatin, and I'm just missing one of those slides there. There was a famous PROMID trial which talked about the benefit of long-acting somatostatin in patients with NET. Initially, it was believed that it only helped to amputate the functional effects of neuroendocrine tumors, but I think over the years, there is growing information that it actually halts the growth of these tumors. Metformin, it is a serendipitous discovery that patients who had diabetes and who were on metformin seemed to fare better when they had a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, despite the fact that they underwent Whipple or resection or a distal pancreatectomy or whatever. And this has been studied prospectively, and it appears that metformin has a therapeutic role. The new kid in the block is lutetium dotatate therapy. So it's a magic bullet. You attach the lutetium to the dotatate, and then it goes and hits the tumor. Pancreatic survival, the response is probably the best. My own imaging people and the nuclear medicine people say that the best results are probably for solid organs, less so for lymph nodes, and least for bowel. A chemosensitizer such as temozolomide or capecitabine is worthwhile. And this is an example of how dramatically the use of each dose of chromogranin actually brings a dramatic fall in the serum chromogranin A levels. Just a little general knowledge that the units that are used is GBQ. GBQ is the units for the patients who get dotatate, lutetium dotatate. And 0.2027 curies is 1 gigabecquerel. One unit is 0.027 curies. And there's a maximum cumulative dose, which is 29.6 gigabecquerel units. There's now been a systematic review and meta-analysis which suggested that it is 78 to 79% response rate, and it's safe, but still more data is required. In patients with liver disease, liver transplantation can even be considered for neuroendocrine tumors, provided the disease is limited to the liver, it cannot be resected by resection, that is. And if there's a year after primary resection without any other recurrence, if there is extrahepatic disease present, that also should be resectable. In general, things should be stable for a year, and other treatments should not be available or must have failed. And the Milan criteria for neuroendocrine tumors is, of course, the confirmed neuroendocrine etiology. Tumor drained by portal system, for example, if the tumor is involved, the parietes, then it's a no-no. There must be not more than 50% hepatic replacement by tumor mets, and a good response to sable disease during the pre-transplant period, and of course, no extra hepatic disease. So if I had to look at an algorithm for neuroendocrine tumors, you divide them into those with a resectable primary and those without a resectable primary. And if it is, if more than 90% of the hepatic mets can be resected, then resect with or without embolization. But if it's diffuse, then you have to use embolization, sandostatin, LAR, or systemic chemotherapy. It's in the patient who have 50 to 70 to 80% of metastasis that and they are resectable and there's no extrahepatic disease, that liver transplantation can be considered. Those without without a resectable primary can only be taken up for palliative surgery, and that has its own limitations. So how, where do we go from here? We need to obviously have a more refined staging system. I'm really concerned that we have now patients who are grade one, but who have extensive liver metastasis, and grade three who have been resected completely R0 and have no obvious residual disease. On an anecdotal basis, I know many patients with grade three who are doing exceptionally well, and many patients in grade zero, grade one who are not. But obviously the basis of G1 to G3 has been the current analysis and current data analysis, which shows that G1s fare better than G3. However, because all patients don't registry, all patients are not analyzed, all patients are not analyzed in a systematic way, I'm afraid that our staging system is still very, very unrefined. The cell biology must be better elucidated. We need to nail down all the genetic issues. We need to find a serum marker for early diagnosis, because chromogranin A actually depends on the volume of tumor. So the bigger the tumor, the more the chromogranin A. So it's not really a great thing, because not a sensitive test for early diagnosis. If you can do molecular pathologic profiling to establish the prognosis, that's great. Of course, the adjuvant therapies currently available are rather, you know, ineffective and inept, except for probably radiation retardation therapy, which has really made a dramatic impact. I want to end by telling the story of a lady who underwent a resection of an extra adrenal pheochromocytoma. It was thought that that was a pancreatic tumor, but it was just retropancreatic. It bled like a stuck pig. The patients had hypertension during the operation and had to be managed with great difficulty. Preoperatively, there was nothing to suggest a possible secreta. After the section, the patient's hypertension, systemic hypertension disappeared, and the patient's diabetes became much better controlled. 3 years later, she developed two liver metastases, which were resected, and they were both in the left lobe, so a left apothecary was done. Further 3 years later, she developed a solitary lung metastasis, which was treated by VATS, video-assisted thoracic surgery, and a staple division of the upper peripheral lesion. Another 4 years further, she's developed metastasis in the rib, for which lutetium dotate therapy was given. I think three sittings were given. And another 7 years later, she's free of disease. And so these are very common in neuroendocrine tumors, that you have patients who survive long periods even with metastatic disease. And that's the message I would like to give at the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for yet another wonderful lecture amongst your busy schedule. There are a few people who raised their hands for questions. I'll start with Dr. Swapnil Saraya.
Sir, my uncle is one of your patients at Ahmedabad. And he underwent a distal pancreatogram with splenectomy for neuroendocrine tumor by Dr. P. Jagannath in 2014. Now, when he visited you, he has a perigastric and a para-aortic group of lymph node that is involved right now in a lutetium dotatate therapy scan. So now what should we do, sir? Actually, what should be the further treatment? Should we wait or should we undergo a resection? And at that time, there was a R0 resection done by Dr. P. Jagannath, sir.
I have no immediate recollection of the entire all the aspects of the case, and I think probably I need to be given a chance to go in detail through the whole story.
We visited you once in Ahmedabad, the Apollo Hospital. Nitin Saraiya is the name of the patient.
Yeah, I can look up my, I have a database which I can look up and I can reply, but I can't tell you offhand.
Okay, sir.
Dr. Ankit?
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah, very much.
Sir, one patient having a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor in the head, and that imaging-wise and staging-wise it is resectable, should we go directly surgery or biopsy and immunohistochemistry is compulsory before surgery?
If a pancreatic lesion is seen and if it's resectable, unless the patient is high risk or it is borderline resectable, or if there are other markers which suggest metastasis, the treatment is resection. This is true of adenocarcinoma, this is true of neuroendocrine tumor.
So if we are doing direct surgery, we are not able to do grading prior to surgery based on G1, G2, G3. So how we can plan our imaging, whether we should do DOTA PET prior to surgery for or FDG PET, because everything is depends on the grading. If it is G1, G2, DOTA PET is preferred for grading.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was saying in the course of my talk, that this G1 to G3 grading is not foolproof yet. We haven't written it in stone. The story of neuroendocrine tumors, like the story of many other diseases, is still in a state of flux. The other way of doing this would be to do a biopsy to then grade the tumor and then do an appropriate PET and then do resection. But remember that it is worthwhile doing primary resection even in the
presence of metastasis.
So when that is one of the understandings of neuroendocrine tumors, why must we go around like that? Why won't we resect the primary? Then we get the grade and everything. Then we can do appropriately whatever PET to see if there's any other disease if you wish. And then follow up the patient thereafter.
हाँ आप ये तो ड्रेन तो डालो ठीक है चलो थैंक्स हाँ काफी होगा
डॉक्टर दीप्ति यू हैव टू म्यूट योर माइक डॉक्टर सुदर्शन व्हाट इज योर क्वेश्चन
यस सर हेलो एम आई ऑडिबल सर
या
यस सर आई एम डॉक्टर सुदर्शन फ्रॉम मेदांता हॉस्पिटल सो माय क्वेश्चन इज रिगार्डिंग इफ इन एन इमेजिंग इफ द प्राइमरी ट्यूमर if it shows invasion or encasement, there are studies that which shows that even if there is encasement or vascular invasion, however, the imaging overestimates the degree of which vascular structures are involved. But intraoperatively, more than 90%, there are chances that the vessels could be dissected off. So, what is your opinion on this? Like, have you encountered?
So, I think it's very simple. If it's a clearly resectable tumor, then you can forget the PET. You can forget any further evaluation and simply go on to resection. But if you find that the tumor is doubtfully resectable, then I would like to know whether this is the only disease or whether there are other diseases, other components as well. And if there are other components, then I would probably want to do a biopsy and then see the grade the tumor. And then probably, although there is no data so far in favor of neoadjuvant therapy, I think lots of us have found, and where the data is only being collated, that even long-acting octreotide has helped in downsizing tumors. Everolimus has. And then resection can be contemplated. So if a patient has, first up, before exploration, if the patient has clear evidence suggestive of vascular invasion, it may be a good idea to do a PET CT, FDG PET, or if you can do an FDG PET and if it doesn't uptake, then you can always do, you can do a DOTA PET, and if it doesn't have to have uptake, you can do an FDG PET. You can do both of them. before you do biopsy. I would like to do biopsy in patients whom I'm going to consider for neoadjuvant therapy, patients whom I'm not going to operate, they're just too high risk or too advanced. And those are the patients I would do biopsy. I would not do biopsy right at the start.
Yeah, Dr. Kislai Kant, what is your question?
So, correct me, sir, if I'm wrong. Before any pancreatic resection, like Whipple's for NET, we do not need any DOTA scan. Am I correct or wrong, sir?
If it is clearly resectable.
Yes, sir.
And a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor is often seen as a hypervascular mass in the pancreas. Vascular infiltration is very clearly seen. It may be a functional tumor or a non-functional tumor. If it's a functional tumor and if there is hyperinsulinism, then you can do even enucleation. If it's a non-insulin but functional tumor, then often a segmental pancreatectomy at least is better because A, it's multiple, B, if it's not, it's usually malignant. And removing some regional lymph nodes is also part of treatment for suspected malignancy. But if it is a large tumor of 5 centimeters, a non-functional pancreatic tumor, then resectability is the key. If it's clearly resectable, then don't do PET now. Resect it.
Okay, sir. And sir, before enucleation for insulinoma, do we need a biopsy proof or just based on the symptom of people's child, we go ahead with enucleation?
So, in an insulinoma, given the insulin glucose ratio being suggestive or definitive, and the imaging criteria, and if the duct is free, and if the size is less than 1 centimeter, 1 centimeter or less, then the chances of malignancy are very remote. Therefore, it is okay to do enucleation. If the tumor is larger, I showed you a picture of a young lady who had a huge tumor. That was an insulinoma as well. She presented with hypoglycemia and she had a 15 centimeter tumor. And that was obviously not a benign tumor.
Dr. Sunil?
Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, regarding post-restriction of this NET, so what is the rationale in deciding whether to give the chemotherapy or not, like this long-acting octreotide? In one case, you had discussed that long-standing loose stools who underwent the surgery and found to have the VIPoma. So post-resection, we can keep quiet or we should give the chemotherapy?
I think it's a good idea to keep quiet all the time. But the point is that, you know, you have now a clear-cut grading of the tumor. If you have removed all the tumor or if you have still disease left, depending on that, you will have to do surveillance. In any case, you have to follow up the patient. Adjuvant therapy will be confined to metastatic disease.
Okay, sir.
Patients who have been completely resected, they can be followed up with a chromogranin as well as what looks like an MR scan, although many others would like to do only a CT.
Okay. Dr. Gautam Vinod?
Sir, my question has been answered, sir.
Okay. So, Dr. Ramesh, there's one question from Facebook group. Purush Reddy, he says, if R1 is achieved in a Whipple specimen for PNET, what are the chances of local recurrence? And does it alter the management post-operatively?
Yes, R1 is, as I showed you in the slide which I presented, the survival is poorer in R1, and they found that a re-resection also did not improve survival. Now, I don't completely trust that paper because given the biology of neuroendocrine tumors, it appears that a re-resection should have provided benefit. So, if this situation were to happen in my hands, of course, I would take the patient's confidence. I would say that there is background data that a re-resection is not helpful. But I would then do a DOTA PET CT based on the based on the histology. And if there is no other disease elsewhere, and if secondarily one can make out that with use of vascular techniques or with use of other techniques, a complete resection can be done, I would think, and I think my oncologist also would think, would suggest only a resurgery. On the other hand, if there is more than one location, then it becomes, of course, a metastatic disease. Then, of course, then we have to try other forms of therapy, including lutetium dotate. Of course, one option nowadays is to consider lutetium dotate in these patients. That is still data still emerging. We haven't got enough patients yet in that group.
Thank you, sir. Swapnil, you have one more question?
Sir, I just asked a previous question. Sir, if perigastric and periaortic group of lymph node are involved, should we go for lutetium dotated therapy or resection, sir?
So, if there are large lymph nodes in the periaortic region, then the best thing would be to do an US guided FNA of those. And they are positive. And if they are the only disease, then I think we have to weigh the pros and cons. Remember again that removal of the primary is beneficial. The removal may be a small distal pancreatectomy, maybe a central pancreatectomy, or maybe a Whipple resection. If it's a Whipple resection, which has a fair amount of morbidity at least, if not mortality, I would again divide it into those with a lot of NETs, which are, because they are indolent, they have dilated pancreatic ducts and they are not secreting pancreas. And they behave very well after surgery. They have very low morbidity. So if in any one of these groups, I would be willing to even do a Whipple resection with clearance of as many lymph nodes as you can, because surgery is still the mainstay of therapy for neuroendocrine carcinoma. On the other hand, if I find that either the PD is not dilated, if a high-risk Whipple is required, and if the periaortic lymph node is positive, then I would consider lutetium therapy. Lutetium therapy for lymph nodes, at least Dr. Sendhil in my hospital says that the data, and I was not able to read the primary data, it was his hearsay, that that's probably the area that works the least effective.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Any further questions before we close the session? So thank you so much, sir, for spending time, especially in the afternoon times during working hours. And we had to come back to you with a few more lectures. Until that time, I'll end the meeting. Thank you very much. Thanks for being
here. Thank you. Bye.